In this video, I'll be going over the 6 steps for Shopify bookkeeping. I'm talking to the Shopify merchants who do their own bookkeeping. This would be the workflow to follow. I'll be doing a step-by-step demonstration on how to do your bookkeeping. I'll be going over recording transactions in and transactions out, the expenses, reconciling accounts. I'll be going over how to analyze for accuracy. If you find any errors, you have to correct them. I'll also talk about the importance of closing the books. And last but not least, sales taxes. So let's go. My name is Julio, and I'm the owner of Kipus Bookkeeping. I specialize in e-commerce bookkeeping for Shopify stores. I help Shopify sellers ease the stress of maintaining their books. So again, this is the Shopify bookkeeping workflow for e-commerce, for Shopify stores specifically. I also serve Amazon and TikTok Shop, but in this video, we'll focus on Shopify. So the first step in the workflow would be to record the transactions. Now, these are transactions coming in, so money coming in and money going out, basically, right? So we have to track all the money movements, sales, expenses. We do transfers, any credit card payment. We record transactions from Shopify, payment processors, and bank accounts. We also have to keep in mind that we have to record the transactions for the fees, the payment processor fees. So that's something to keep in mind. And now I'm going to show you a demonstration on how to do that in QuickBooks. So here we are in the banking feed of this e-commerce store. And here we see all the transactions that came through in the month. Now, this is the month didn't end yet in this video. So and some transactions have already gone through, but I'll be showing you how the point of this is to not have any transactions left in here. This is where we categorize them or we add them. And this is where we match the transactions. So the first thing to do would be here in all dates, we have to choose the month that we're working in. In this case, it would be March. Now, as of this video, the month didn't end yet. So these are not all the transactions that will come through. I have to come back here and keep categorizing the transactions. So we chose the month. So these are all the transactions in March. We can see we have Afterpay, a payment for the credit card. We also have to make sure we record that. These are the PayPal transactions, Shopify transactions, some Affirm transactions. Now, like I said, these are not all the transactions. I've already pushed some through. You know, we still have a couple of days left in the month. So what I like to do is I like to, in the description, I like to, you know, I guess categorize them by description. So this way they're all, you know, like I see all PayPal here. And if I know that I already have a rule for these PayPal transactions, all I have to do is pretty much click them all. So once I click all of them, transfer PayPal bank clearing, because you know I have to do the it has to go into the clearing account. So then I would have to go through all of these and start. I would have to start categorizing all of this, right? See, these are all the categorized transactions here. As you can see here. I work with A2X, which is a connector app. Basically, it connects Shopify to QuickBooks. So all the sales that happen in Shopify, it brings them over to QuickBooks and it makes a journal entry recording the sale, right? It's summarized transactions. It doesn't give you details. I'll give you a demonstration on how to categorize these transactions. So these are the bank feeds for Shopify. And it says it found one match. This is the journal entry that A2X made. So basically, I click them all, right? And the purpose of this is to, there can't be anything in the bank feed. Everything has to be cleared. You have to categorize all of them, right? So once I click, of course, you have to like double check that they are the right match, right? Once you click all the ones that are, that you know that they're Shopify and that it found the match, you click accept. And those are now categorized, right? So you would do the same thing for PayPal. You know, you will do the same thing for PayPal after you create, you know, the rule if you want to make sure that these transactions go into the PayPal bank clearing. These are three more Shopify transactions that I still have to look at. I think this one is the Shopify bill. Here's another transaction. So you just have to keep going through these. So for Slack, for example, this is a software expense. You hit add and it categorizes that, right? So you just have to keep going through this. And once all of this is clean, you move on to the credit card, right? So basically, again, here, I have a rule for Google Ads. You just add it. You go through all of this again. Also make sure you're doing you can see here, 25, 69, 15, it's the payment that came from the check-in. 25, 69, 15. So make sure you can either record it as a transfer to the credit card, or record as a credit card payment. I like to do it as a transfer, and you hit add, and then once you go to the credit card, it says it's going to find the match, right? So it finds this match, and you hit, this is the payment that we just made on the checking account, and you hit match. You start going through all of these transactions, and the point of this is to not have anything left over in the banking feed. So go through all of that, and then we move on to the next step. The next step in the bookkeeping workflow for e-commerce sellers, it's to reconcile the accounts. This is basically to ensure that the bookkeeping records match the statements, the bank statements. You have to make sure you reconcile PayPal, you reconcile Shopify. And it's important to reconcile regularly, specifically bank accounts, right? You have to reconcile them every month. So in this case, I would have to reconcile the checking account. I have to reconcile the credit card account and PayPal. I have to reconcile Shopify to what I have in QuickBooks to what I have in Shopify. I'll show you what I mean by that. And again, you have to do this regularly. This way you catch any discrepancies. So let's go back to QuickBooks. Reconciling bank accounts and credit card accounts, there's tutorials for that in YouTube, and you can find one quite easy, and it'll show you. But just if you do all the transactions right and you record all the transactions in and out, it should be somewhat simple. I'll show you a reconciliation from before, right? You have to make sure that everything that happened in the bank happened in QuickBooks, and everything that's recorded in QuickBooks happened in the bank. You don't want to have a sale recorded in QuickBooks, but you didn't really make that sale. Something that was recorded twice. This is why we reconciled. So the sale came through in the bank, came through in QuickBooks. It happened in both places, right? Something very important to keep in mind is payment processor fees. The deposit that is made into QuickBooks, into the bank feed, might not be the same as the deposit that you get in your bank. And this is because payment processors, they take their fees. So make sure you take that into consideration. Make sure you record the payment processor fees. I have a video in my channel about how to record and how to do the journal entries in the payment processor fees. So I'll try to link that up too. And if you just go through my YouTube channel, you'll find it. I'll go through it on how to record the fees. And I made sure that everything that happened in the bank also happened in QuickBooks, right? In here, and you can record this Shopify expense as a software expense. You add it, and that's how you record your Shopify bill expense. So I'll show you how to do the journal entry for payment processors. I also have a video which you should check out to it goes into a bit more detail. So I'll show you a journal entry. Pretty much, what you have to do is find out how much your fees are, right? Once you find out how much your fees are, you have to record that in, and I'll show you. So this is an example of how to record payment processor fees. So you would, put the date. This is December. You put the expense, payment processor fees, Afterpay fees. In this case, it was $49.34, and you put that into the clearing account. I think I have a video on clearing accounts. If not, I'll try to do one. But basically, what happens is you have a sale for 200, and Afterpay deposits 195 to the bank feed, right? And so you'll be short $5, but you're not really short. It's the fees that Afterpay took. So you'll have a balance of the $5. But then once you record this fee, it'll match. Let's show you. All right, so we're at the Afterpay clearing account, and you can see these are all the journal entries, the sales that come in from A2X, right? And then the deposits from Afterpay. And here are the fees. Here are the fees. So if I didn't have this, you see with the 4113, it's a rounding error, but then that would bring you back to balance on your account. But if we keep going down, in January, at the end of January, the Afterpay fees is what brings you down to the zero again. It brings you down to balance. So that's why e-commerce is a bit difficult, because there's a lot of timing differences, so many transactions and so many payment processors that it'll sometimes Look like it's not matching, but it's just the timing differences that it looks like that. And we also reconcile a different way just to make sure that this is right. I'll show you that right now, actually. So I have a spreadsheet. So I have this spreadsheet here with the months January through December. It just shows you sales in Shopify and sales in QBO, right? So the first thing I would do is I would go into, once I finish, all the first steps, I'll go into profit and loss. Right. And then I go into sales. I group by transaction type. I can see all the transactions that came in. I can get the total. I can get the total, and then I would put that total in here. And then I would choose, the month I'm working with, December in this case. And then I would see the sales here. I see all the sales, and I'll make sure that matches to what I have in QuickBooks. And this way, that's an extra step that I take to make sure that everything is good and everything matches. If something doesn't match, I have to like dig into it and research what happened. So I would do that for all these, for the income, for the discounts, the returns, the shipping, sales taxes, liabilities, and then I will go through the payment processors. Step three comes in, right? We have to analyze for accuracy. So what does this mean? Pretty much you review the financial reports of any unexpected balances, or inconsistencies. You can see your sales, your expenses. If, for example, you have, software expense of like 5,000 a month, and then suddenly November or whatever month, it's $100, then there's something to look at and keep and make sure that you review and you analyze. And the same thing goes for any other expense. And also it goes for sales, right? If you have sales that are this is when you review the accounts. If you have sales of 100,000 a month, and then suddenly it drops down to 10,000. You have to look into it and make sure that everything is fine. That's when you make sure the books are accurate. And the way to do that pretty much is you go to the profit and loss, and then you start pretty much looking through it, right? You can look through, a couple of months back and see if there's a pattern, and just hit by month, and you run the report, and then you can see all the sales, what how you're doing, if there's an increase, a spike or something, if there's a spike or a drop, you can look into that. Same thing with expenses. You also look through the balance sheet. You also have to look at your sales taxes. Make sure that, if you have too much liabilities in your sales taxes, it means you might not be paying sales taxes. So make sure liabilities have to go up, and then you make a payment, right? So that's how you review. And, hand in hand, it goes with step four, which is correct any errors. So like I said, if you find something that doesn't make sense, really, this is the time when you correct them, right? You adjust transactions entries or correct any mistakes that you find during your analysis. Maintain and keep accurate records. It's the most important thing. That's what we do. Correcting errors is, again, you go in here into fulfillment expenses, right? And this is not really what, let's say this is not really a fulfillment expense. You go to the expense, and you can just change it here. You categorize to something else, right? Maybe it's an Afterpay fee. So you put an Afterpay fee in here, right? So that's how you would fix any errors. You fix any errors and make sure you're doing the right thing. Yeah, so that's how you correct any errors. We close the books because we don't want to make mistakes in previous months that the books match, they reconcile, they're clean. And then by mistake, you make a transaction there and it just throws everything off. And then you have to see what happened. And then, because it's a mistake, you put the wrong date. You're not realizing you have to go way back then. So it's better to close the books. And the way you close the books is pretty simple. Accounts and settings, advanced. And you close the books here. This is where you close the books. And the best part of all to do with sales taxes. E-commerce sellers have a responsibility to collect, file, and remit sales taxes. Keep in mind that each state has different regulations. Each state has different thresholds for economic nexus. There's physical and economic nexus. So, physical is the place where you have your corporation or you have your building, you have inventory. And economic nexus is pretty much where you make sales. There's different thresholds for each state. Some states are like if you make 200 transactions, you have to start paying taxes. Or if you have sales of more than 100,000, you have to start paying taxes. So it's important to look into that. And it's also important to have a dedicated time for this. Make sure you're setting up some time. And if possible, have somebody that really knows what they're doing do this, because it could get a little hectic. like I mentioned, with collecting and filing and doing the returns. So those are the six bookkeeping steps for Shopify stores, for Shopify sellers. We'll go through it again really quick. Quick recap, you know, record transactions, you reconcile all the accounts, you analyze for accuracy, you correct any errors, close the books, and make sure you file your sales taxes. It's basically six steps, but within each step, there's important things that you have to keep in mind, important things you have to take care of. So I hope this helps. If you have any questions, leave them in the comment section below. If you need help with your bookkeeping, I can help you. I'll leave a link for ways you can reach me, for ways you can get in touch with me. It's important to know that e-commerce bookkeeping can be complex and can be hectic, especially when you're dealing with a lot of transactions, a lot of selling platforms, payment processors. It could get pretty daunting kind of quick. The store that I showed you in the demonstration was a simple one, but just keep in mind that it could get complex quick. So you should have an open mind into considering getting help from a specialized e-commerce bookkeeper, which is me. So again, thank you for your time, and I'll see you in the next video.